You're listening to Boobies and Newbies, brought to you by the Frolic Podcast Network. And welcome to a special holiday edition of Boobies and Newbies, the podcast that asks novice romance readers to think outside the dick in a box and brave the unbridled world of erotica. I'm your host, Kelly Reynolds, and today's romance review marks the second episode in Boobies and Newbies' annual holiday special, The 12 Days of Boobsmas. Y'all, we are just getting started. Today, we are traveling back in time to an era defined by two-week-long holiday house parties, extravagant snow sculptures, and way too many layers of clothing. So fasten your corsets and hang on to your wig curls, because we've got 12 holiday-themed romances and 12 mini-pods coming your way throughout December. That also means that we've got 12 holiday romance prize packs to give away to listeners just like you. So please keep up with us across social media all month long, as I will be sharing ways to win around the clock. Please also join me and a guest live on Instagram every Friday in December, where I will be announcing the next batch of giveaway winners. The first of which is actually happening tonight, December 3rd. So I hope to see everybody there, and I wish you could all be winners, but you're all winners in my heart. So that's all that matters. One final thing, and that is this. If you feel like making one more person's holiday a little bit brighter, you might consider leaving this podcaster a review on Apple Podcasts. You can also join the Boobies and Newbies Patreon family for as little as $1 a month and have instant access to bonus episodes, exclusive swag, and so much more. But for now, it's on to the Boobsmas festivities. Joining me today is returning Boobsmas guest and one of my all-time internet friends, although someday I hope we will actually meet in person. She's a writer, a reader, a YouTuber, and the founder of the Cozy Mystery Book Club. Please join me in welcoming Angela Maria Hart.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. Oh my gosh, I am so honored and so happy to be back and talking with you. I really am just... I love that introduction. You make me smile and make me laugh. And you're just such a bright little ray of positivity. If people are not already subscribed to this podcast and supporting you on Patreon and following you everywhere across platforms, they need to do that right now. I mean, seriously, as we're talking, hit that follow button, because she is amazing. She will brighten your day and just all the romance fun.
Oh my gosh. Well, thank you for that glowing introduction. I feel like I should just turn the reins over to you from now on, because I am crap at promoting myself. So I think you do a much better job of it.
Well, first of all, I adore you wholeheartedly. I mean, I think everything you do is just so much fun. And you've taken to doing this thing on Instagram, and I've been noticing this because it makes me so happy every single time, and I bookmark and save them. You'll find these tweets that are romance related, and you'll share them with your little pink backdrop, so everything looks uniform on her Instagram, by the way, which is true. One of those things that, yeah, they always tell you to do that when they're teaching you about Instagram. Oh, you have to have your color palette. So she's got the color palette. It works. But it's, you got those tweets, and they're just, they hit the heart of romance. You talk about, oh, everything under the sun with the tweets that you find. I don't know how you find them. I don't know how they come across your timeline,
but when you reshare them. They find me. That's really how it happens. I mean, on it, because I think, you know, as much as I love to read and to write and to say things, I feel like I don't always have the best way to say what I want to say. And so when something like that comes across my timeline where I'm like, oh my gosh, yes, I have always had this thought, but I never had the foresight to like actually write it down and share it with the world. And thankfully somebody else did. Then of course I want to share it with everybody else, because it makes me laugh. It makes me think. I love a good thing that sparks some sort of conversation or debate amongst people. So yes, I am here for always resharing tweets about romance from people in romance.
But you're finding like these epic moments. And again, I'm someone who's very invested in romance landia. And I don't see some, like, I want to say about 60 of the ones that you share, I've never seen before. Like, you're the only reason I find them. And there was one the other day, it was, I forget, it had to do with the representation and the stigmatization with, oh, it's just porn for women. And I saw that, I saw the little snippet that you included, and I didn't see that on my own Twitter or the Romantics at Heart Twitter, which I have for just romance novels, and it wasn't on the home feed. And yet I see you have it, and I was going, oh, thank God you have this, because this speaks to something I'm so interested in. And then I got to go follow that person and see the chain, and like, that's all because of you.
Oh, well, thank you. I'm glad I'm doing something. I mean, obviously there's a lot of people who don't even know I have a podcast because I hardly ever talk about the podcast, but that's not even my main goal in doing Boobies and Newbies. Like, honestly, I just like having a place where people can come to talk about romance. And I know it's a very similar thing for you, not just with romance, because I know that you're also an avid romance reader, but you've created the Cozy Mystery Book Club and 12 Days of Cozies to have, you know, this forum for people to gravitate towards, that whether they're an author, a reader, an aspiring writer, that just want to talk about cozy mysteries. And I have found that there is a lot of crossover too between the people who both read and write romance and also the people who read and write cozies.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I think I've become more aware of this as I've been doing the Cozy Mystery, like as I've done the Cozy Mystery Book Club, and that's become my sort of, I wouldn't call it like my positive outlet, because my dissertation is on the romance genre fandom. And so I study the romance genre inside and out. And so the more the dissertation takes part, the more I'm actually reading cozy mysteries, because I need a break from romance in my off time.
Yeah.
And so it's funny though, because a lot of the research will then actually correlate to what I'm reading, because we have the female sleuthers, we have the female writers, we have, you know, very healthy best friends. So you see women relationships that are very healthy. They show that women in a positive light, instead of sometimes with romance where it's like, oh, we're competing for the same guy or something. No, they're trying to hunt down the killer together, which is very different. But they have some of the similar tropes about baking, and they're actually embracing it, saying like, yo, you know, baking tends to be a very female dominated area, or this is something women do, but hey, we have recipes. This is a trope. Look at how awesome this baking. I mean, they have those bakery shops in the books. I'm like, I just want to jump into the story.
Oh,
like,
my gosh.
Yeah, can I get one of those muffins, please? Thank
yes,
you.
The amount of times that I have read not only romance but cozy mysteries as well, and just especially because there a lot of cozies tend to be set in a small town environment, and that's a trope that we also see in romance novels, and just wanting to like make this town a reality and exist in that town, and then finding out it is not a real place and crying myself to sleep at night.
There's this artist on Fiverr, and I really wish that I myself had like a cozy mystery ready to go. I've been working on it, you know, in the all the spare time that I have, you know, dissertation and everything else.
I have no doubt.
Comes around. But I really was like, oh, what is my favorite cozy mystery town? Because the artist does maps. They do illustrations of maps. Oh. And I was like, they can make the cozy mystery location come to life. Be like, this is where the school is. This is where the bakery is. And I just think that would be the most amazing thing to see come to life. The cozy mystery town as a map in that way. I really want to do that.
Oh,
that's
my
goal
right now. No, I think you should. And honestly, I think a lot of other authors, regardless of what you're writing, should consider that as an opportunity, because I know I have two maps from authors. I have one from Susan Mallory that I think is part of her Fool's Gold series. And I have one from Lucy Eden, who when she released the book that takes place in Culver City, in Los Angeles, what is it called? My Book Boyfriend, Blind Date with a Book Boyfriend.
I remember that book because the title is just so epic.
It's so cute. And it takes place in and around Culver City, which I used to live nearby in LA. And she has all these really cute stops on it, as well as like, you know, where the Ripped Bodice bookstore would be and everything. And I just thought it was so cute. And I have both of them up on my bookcase. And I think if you're a fan of a series, especially because we're not talking about just one book, we're talking about like a series, a world that they are creating. Mm-hmm. What's different about having a map up on your wall from Susan Mallory's book than having a map up on your wall from like Game of Thrones?
I mean, I would be very interested in seeing where the Ripped Bodice would be on that map. I mean, I think it would be really awesome to see more romance maps and just cozy mystery maps in general. This is such a random little tangent digression we're talking about right here, but it's so much fun and I'm loving
but
this.
it's why it's important to, and I know that there are plenty of authors who, you know, write for themselves as much as they write for their readers, and so they don't want to necessarily like read reviews and like read negative comments, and I completely understand that and find that so valid, because you also don't want it to derail your creativity and like your train of thought. But at the same time, readers have ideas that, just like I can't always say the things that I want to say on Twitter, and I share the words of other people who do say them in a much more eloquent way. Readers have ideas that they can't necessarily create themselves. Like, I want to see this story. I don't know how to write it. I want somebody else to write it. Or, oh my gosh, wouldn't it be cool if there was like a map or an illustration to go with this story? Like, these are the things that, this is why like the relationship between readers and writers is so important, is just to share these ideas and, you know, explore them together or not. I mean, take them or leave them, but at least acknowledge the fact that they're there and somebody wants to give them to you.
I mean, I'll start the petition for people who want maps for those mysteries and romance novels. I think that would be really cool.
You'll be map coordinator.
you just got me thinking too. What was it? Tessa Bailey, her latest, It Happened One Night with the Alexis from Schitt's Creek.
Oh yeah, It Happened One Summer. Loved it.
Okay, thank you. I was trying to remember it because I can picture the book cover where she's standing there in that dress and he's got that very laid back appeal. I'm going, that'd be really cool to have a little map that ends with that lighthouse off in the corner, or just have that be the center of it maybe, and have everything else go around it. There can be some fun had here with
and
this.
And anybody who's listened to our Steamy Spotlight interview with Tessa Bailey from, I want to say October, knows that the town that she set It Happened One Summer in is an actual town in Washington. And so it's only a matter of a few hours drive from where I live. And she's actually been invited to go to the town to do some sort of like book launch or event for the second book. And so I, for one, am already planning to attend if that does in fact happen, because that's another idea, is to like visit different locations, like do like book tours. It makes me think of my friend who does the blog Literary Dates, Lauren. She writes about books that are set in New York City and will take herself on dates to see different locations from the books.
That's amazing. What is it called? Julia Cameron's The Artist Way, the morning pages, the author dates. Mm. That sounds like one of the, like a reader date, not an author date, a reader date, going to the locations in your book.
Oh man, you're just giving me more ideas and projects for 2022. Like, this is just, neither of us have the bandwidth to add more to our plate, and yet here we are. So let's talk about what we already have going on before we start planning future ventures. So obviously we have to talk about the 12 Days of Cozies. As this episode is releasing, we are on day 3 of the 12 Days of Cozies. So please, please brief everyone on what you've got in store.
Oh my goodness. I feel as if we're such a lethal romance cozy combination when we come together, because just so many things are like, we got this idea and this idea. And I'm thinking, oh, I want to do maps now. Oh my goodness. Every time we talk, it's like something comes of it. Creative juices, all like the positivity in the, I mean, because too, we're also like excited. Like, we're talking about maps. This is great. Somebody else will be like, maps? What? So I adore you. No,
the feeling's mutual.
I just wanted to throw that in there. I get the biggest kick out of you. No, 12 Days of Cozies is my, this is my baby. I've been working on this since literally last 12 Days of Cozies. I kid you not. I really can't. It's one of those things where it sounds like I'm exaggerating, but I wish I were. Oh, my little planner heart. This was my ongoing project this year. Whenever it was late at night and I was having my insomnia issues, let's make another bingo board. So yeah, there's a lot of fun coming. Every morning I'm going to be sending out an email newsletter. So if you open that email, you are automatically entered to win that giveaway, because every email newsletter comes with a giveaway. And I made sure those were all ebooks or audiobooks. This way, depending on where you are, you will not have any issues trying to get this mail to you, whether you're international or you are in the US, no matter where you are.
Very smart. Very smart.
That was one of my big things. I wanted to make sure that everybody's able to win something, regardless of platform, regardless of format. As soon as you start nodding, you're like, I've heard these comments before too on my end.
Yeah. Well, and you know, take it from somebody who I love sending mail. And so should I send audiobooks and you know, ebooks as giveaway prizes? Absolutely. Do I? No.
I'm very happy with the lineup that's been created because the authors are being so generous. So there are the ebook giveaways and the audiobook giveaways, and they're not just limited to the email newsletter. There's also going to be giveaways for ebooks and audiobooks for Twitter and Instagram as well. So there's also going to be daily Instagram and Twitter giveaways. The Twitter giveaway goes live, I believe, at 9 or 9:30 every day. And then the Instagram giveaway goes live at 11. And so you have the Instagram photo challenges as well. Mm. And super fun, there's actually going to be a giveaway for everyone who posts photos for 12 Days of Cozy. So if you post a photo and tag 12 Days of Cozies, or just tag the Cozy Mystery Book Club, I should say use the hashtag 12 Days of Cozies and tag the Cozy Mystery Book Club on Instagram, you are automatically entered to win a giveaway. And I have quite a few of them lined up for everyone who takes photos. I'm very pleased. I got the book club enamel pins. We got some Perlac homes. We got the little keychain for our mascot. Ooh. In the works. I know we have sleuthers who are hearing impaired, or I know we have sleuthers who are visually impaired. And so that's why I've been working on having transcripts, so that if you can't listen to one of the live streams, you can go read about it. So I'm trying to be really, really aware and make sure everyone's included. So that's why I also wanted the different platforms. So if you don't have a Twitter, you can be on Instagram, or vice versa. So that was something I was trying to be very conscientious about. And then in the evenings, there are going to be Twitter reading sprints from 5 to 8 p.m. The reading sprints are going to be 20-minute increments, and then you have 5 minutes to go recharge, get another cup of tea, coffee, and 5 minutes to chat before it picks up again on the 30-minute mark or the hour mark. And then at 8 o'clock, so from 8 to 9 p.m. EST, there are going to be Cozy Mystery authors ready to chat with you live. And so this lineup, I believe we have 50 authors at the moment.
Whoa.
Yes.
Well, I'm so excited, though. I, you know, and I love that you do this every year, and I feel like it's bigger, it's better every year. So where can everybody find and follow you and subscribe? Because, you know, there are still plenty of days left in the 12 Days of Cozy to get involved.
One of the things I'm very proud of is the website this year. I have the complete list of featured authors, and I have their websites linked so you can find your new favorite author and go follow them across platforms. But I also have all these extra pages with the bingo boards, with the downloads for the Instagram challenges and adult coloring book pages. There's bookmarks to download. There's mazes.
Yes.
There's all this extra stuff just on the website itself. But I am very happy with how this content is being.
So to basically sum everything up, I mean, you've got the website. You can follow Cozy Mystery Book Club on Twitter, Instagram, mm-hmm. subscribe to the newsletter. So many opportunities to win, yes. to meet some great people, to interact with some authors, to take home some awesome giveaway prizes. And I've taken home giveaway prizes from Angela before, so I can say that they are awesome giveaway prizes. So
I can't help myself.
Yeah.
One of the things I do is I really do love the book club. And when I say it's my positive outlet, I truly mean that. And so if you post a photo for our book of the month, I will send you a bookmark. And when I say I will send you a bookmark, I'm going to be sending you at least two, probably more.
Probably some
with stickers. And other goodies. Yeah, I'm going to say, like, I'm going to pack that envelope with as much stuff as I can to bring a smile to your face. So that's why you say do the giveaways. I'm like, yeah, if you want to post a photo for our book of the month, I will send you something. So I like doing the giveaways because I think that's one of the love languages for me, like showing how much I appreciate you.
Yeah, no, it's funny because there's the love language of gifts. And I tell people, I'm like, look, I like give me a gift shirt. That's fine. But I love picking out the perfect gift for somebody. I love sending gifts. I love sharing, you know, any sort of extra. It's just one of the things that I love. I feel like I could have been a personal shopper, like in another life. So maybe this one, I don't know, maybe I'll get bored and just move on to the next thing. And
I just had an image of you in a Hallmark movie. I was like,
right?
This is her new Hallmark love story.
And there totally is a Hallmark movie about a personal shopper, by the way. It's very cute. And he's a surly businessman who doesn't like desserts, but she changes his way, you know, the usual. But no, I'm glad to have you back for 12 Days of Boobsmas, especially especially since the last time you were here, we read a contemporary Christmas romance. And so this time we are taking it back and we're heading to 1800s England. So without further ado, I'll tell everybody that today's reading selection is Mistletoe Christmas, an anthology by various authors. And today, Angela and I will actually be discussing the first two stories in this anthology, which are A Mistletoe Kiss by Eloisa James and Wishing Under the Mistletoe by Christi Caldwell. And I will be discussing the second set of stories in a future Boobsmas episode, but all you really need to know is that all four stories in this anthology take place surrounding the same outlandish annual holiday extravaganza known as the revelry. You can read them out of order. You can start where we did with the first two stories. There are some interlinking characters. However, beyond that, they each pretty much function as standalone novellas. So start wherever you like. And this anthology was published in September of this year, 2021. It's available on Amazon for $6.99 Kindle edition, although I will give a special shout out to our friends at Avon for providing me with an early copy of this book, as well as supplying a few extra copies for our lucky giveaway winners. So I'll have one to give away today and one for our future Mistletoe Christmas episode. That being said, I'm going to give everybody the synopsis, and what they've done with the synopsis for this anthology is sort of like kind of wrap together all of the stories. So I'm actually just going to give the whole synopsis. It would be like a little weird to just sort of stop halfway through, and I'll do the same thing in the next Mistletoe Christmas episode, just so people, whether you caught one before the other or not, are all caught up. So this is the summary for the full anthology series, Mistletoe Christmas. The Duke of Greystoke's Christmas revelry is famous throughout the British Isles for its plays, dancing, magical grotto, not to mention scandals leading to the marriage licenses he hands out like confetti. But not everyone welcomes a visit from Cupid. Lady Cressida, the Duke's daughter, is too busy managing the entertainments. And besides, her own father has called her dowdy. Her cousin, Lady Isabelle Wilkshire, is directing Cinderella and has no interest in marriage. Lady Caroline Whitmore is already unhappily married. The fact that she and her estranged husband have to pretend to be together just makes her dread the party all the more, but not as much as Miss Louisa Harcourt, whose mother bluntly tells her that this is her last chance to escape the horrors of being an old maid. A house party so large that mothers lose track of their charges leads to a delightful, seductive quartet of stories that you will savor for the season. So if anybody remembers any of the names that I just said in that synopsis, I will tell you that the two stories we're discussing today revolve around Lady Cressida, the one managing the entertainments, and Lady Isabelle, who is directing the play Cinderella. So I've done anthologies in the past, and I've actually done them for Boobsmas before. This is the first time that I'm kind of sandwiching in a couple stories into an episode as opposed to just one per episode. However, they're very short. They're each about 100 pages, a little bit over. So I thought, you know, especially since they take place at the same location, there's a lot of the same characters involved, it would just make sense for us to kind of be able to tackle a couple of stories at once. So that's why we're doing that. Angela, I will ask you, first of all, are you familiar with any and or all of the authors involved in this anthology?
So Eloisa James is a longtime favorite of mine. I was very fortunate to meet her. I want to say I met her for the first time a couple of years ago at Politics and Prose. It was so funny. This was one of my first real, in real life romance book events. And it was her, Beverly Jenkins, Mia Sosa, and it was Lisa Kleypass. And so
good,
that was the first.
Lord,
that was the first event.
Those are heavy hitters.
I know. And I think Mia Sosa had actually just published one of her first books at the time. So she was relatively unknown. But now she's got The Worst Best Man, which has just skyrocketed. And now, I mean, talk about a panel. And so
yes.
She was on the panel and I got to meet her in person. I was fangirling so hard. I was like, that's Eloisa James over there. And so I ended up meeting her a couple other times since then. And I've been able to control myself. I mean, internally fangirled completely, but she's a romance writing goddess. What she's done for the genre in regards to doing the documentary, like Love Between the Covers and mm-hmm. talking about it. And I just appreciate the fact that she embraces it. And she herself is a Shakespeare professor and she really does go to back saying like, hey, I am an educated, smart woman. I have these degrees. I'm doing this and I am writing romance. And she actually just published her first book with her real name, her birth name, and not just Eloisa James, which is a pen name. So she just did the first one with that. And so she's really done a lot for the genre. And so I'm always really happy when I see her name. And it's so, so funny with this book cover because her name is it's twice the size of all the other authors on the book cover.
I know. She is definitely, and I feel like you find that when it comes to a lot of anthologies. Like I'm thinking of the one that we read, what was the one? I did one last year. I think that was a lot of cowboys, and I know that Kate Pierce was featured in it, but you're right, there's usually like kind of like the top billing sort of thing. And I will say though, like, you know, I'm familiar with all four of the authors. Jana McGregor, I actually did interview as part of my bookstore romance day panel mm-hmm. with Love Sweet Arrow, and so it was great to chat with her. Erica Ridley, I don't know why I feel like we've reviewed for the podcast before, I can't think of what book it would have been. So I have read Erica Ridley. I don't know how much Christi Caldwell I've actually read.
She's the only one I don't think I was super familiar with, and hers is actually one of the ones we're talking about today.
Yeah, and I really enjoyed her story too. So
me too.
At this point of recording, I have only read the first two stories, the stories that we're discussing today. I will be reading, like I said, the next two and discussing them. But I wanted to focus on these two stories specifically. So I don't really know, what's coming next other than what's been said in the synopsis. So yeah, so let's start with A Mistletoe Kiss by Eloisa James. And this one, first of all, love the name of our heroine in this one, Lady Cressida. The name Cressida is just, it's one of those names that I'm like, the only place you could get away with the name Cressida is in a historical romance novel. Like if I met a Cressida today, I would automatically think Bond villain, but in a romance novel, no. She is a heroine unto her own. And so,
well, what about his name? He's Elias something Darcy. Elias.
I thought that was pretty hot too. I thought those were both really good names. But
he has Darcy in there, like Mr. Fitzwilliam Darcy.
Yeah.
So I was going, hey, Eloisa, we getting a little bit of, Jane, we getting a little bit of Jane Austen in the mix?
Could be. Yeah, I do think, I kept thinking about that as I was reading both the stories. I feel like there were certain moments where I would almost tie them into other stories, especially Christmas stories, because I know in the case of the second story, the one by Christi Caldwell, I kept thinking, oh, this kind of has sort of a Christmas Carol.
It was Scrooge. Vibe. That was literally what it was. He refers to his partner as Marley, his partner, like Jacob Marley.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I was like, okay, am I reading too much into this by the fact that his partner's name is Marley? And then also that it's sort of when you, if anybody has read or seen A Christmas Carol, whatever version, whether it's the Muppets or, not, there's always that look into the past when he is hanging out with Ghost of Christmas Past that shows him as the young man where he was in love and he had this woman that he was like so devoted to and he wanted to make more money to support her. And I was like, oh, that's exactly what this story is. That, but they also each have their own passion. So yeah, I did like, but we're getting ahead of ourselves. Let's focus on.
Oh no, I'm nodding along because I'm right there for it. Because growing up, ever since I was probably 6 years old, my parents would always take me to go see the Christmas Carol and they would do the stage play of it. And I'm very, very familiar with the Christmas Carol. And so every time I was looking for little details in the story and I was finding them because his lost love's name was Belle and her name is Isabelle. I was going to say, I'm going to give the author credit for getting all of those minute little details in there because that's not something, the more familiar you are with the Christmas Carol, the more you're going to appreciate this story because she really got all these little details.
Easter eggs.
She really got them. And again, if you're familiar with it, you're going to be going, oh, she did this, she did that. Oh, that's so clever. Even just having the Marley reference in there, like you're just gonna be in it.
You'll appreciate this then, because I just got back from New York recently, and when I was there, the theater kid in me is like, you do not wait 30 years to go to New York and not see a show. So of course I wanted to see a show, and rather than go see like one of the big Broadway ones, I went to an off-Broadway New Works production of A Sherlock Christmas Carol. And I was like, hold up, wait a second. I love everything British. I love everything Sherlock. I love A Christmas Carol. We have to make this happen. And that's exactly how I felt while watching it, was like, if you're familiar with both the world of Sherlock, so you know names like Moriarty and Elementary, my dear Watson, and his love, Irene Adler. And then you have the world of A Christmas Carol, where you know the different ghosts and, you know, the basic premise of it. You would appreciate it so much more. Now, granted, I think you could appreciate it in general the same way I feel like you could appreciate Christi Caldwell's story in this book without knowing that narrative. But if you do know it, oh my gosh, those little tee-hee moments you're going to have as a reader, or as I was as a watcher of A Sherlock Christmas Carol, were amazing.
How did I not know this was a thing? I'm going to be Googling
it's
this.
New.
Like, did somebody film this?
New.
It literally, you guys doing a YouTube video?
We were there in the first week, and it's only there until Christmas. Like, it is a small, my hope is that it'll become one of those plays that then, like, maybe next Christmas will be in different cities around America, yeah. Because I would take my parents to see that. I have a lot of friends who would love to see that. So yeah, keep an eye out for A Sherlock Christmas Carol.
That's amazing. I need to go look into this.
So that is the second book, or the second story in this anthology, is Christi Caldwell's story. But let's not look past Eloisa James's story, A Mistletoe Kiss, which kicks things off. And honestly, I think this is a good one to start the anthology with as well, because Cressida, our heroine of this novella, is the most connected with the revelry. This insane party. I love a good party that lasts for 2 weeks, you know?
I have to admit, I felt a kindred spirit with her when she starts talking about how she's planning this event. Because, again, when I said I was planning 12 Days of Cozies, I was not kidding. I've been doing this for months and months and months. And so this is all online. And this woman's doing in-person magical grottos. She's doing this. She's doing that. I'm going, I feel you. I feel you, Cressida. Yeah. I feel you. I know what you're talking about.
All year long, she is planning this event for people to come stay 2 weeks. And she's handpicking the people that get to come based off of, like, you know, all the news in the papers. It's very Bridgerton, like Lady Whistledown, yeah. Where you're like, ooh, you've been in the news, you might not make the cut. Like,
and someone has things to say about you.
Exactly. And so, and but then again, it's her father who is really the one taking responsibility, or no, not taking responsibility, claiming responsibility. Yeah. For this event, an event he started many years ago that Cressida has since taken over and basically put her heart and soul into, regardless of whether she wants to or not. And he is taking all the credit for it.
If you read this story in this anthology, you will not like her father at all.
Oh, no,
you will
he
not
sucks.
Like this guy. You
he
won't
sucks.
Like him.
And he is on, I don't know if I've ever had this reaction while reading. He is actually on his deathbed, like, dying throughout this story. Like, we haven't actually seen him die in the first two,
but you're waiting for it to happen.
But you know it's going to happen. He's determined to wait until revelry is over, and you're just like, yeah, you know what, if you die, I'm not going to be sad. I'm really not going to be sad about it, because he is just not a nice person. And to see somebody not be nice to a stranger, or, you know, a colleague, is one thing, but to see them not be nice to their own daughter, who they are willing to take away her dowry, take away the one, their home in Scotland that, like, she's always wanted, and just give it to somebody else as a bribe to continue on this stupid party after you are dead, is just vile. I mean, he's an awful person.
Everything that comes out of his mouth with the dialogue that's, you know, pen to paper, it's awful. The way he treats his daughter, wouldn't wish that on anybody. Mm-mm. She, essentially, Cressy is 23. She is unmarried. we find out throughout the duration of the story that he's taken away a lot of her opportunities for marriage to potentially leave him. So instead of having a full season, she just had one ball or one event, and apparently that was it. She didn't get any special clothing. She didn't get to get dressed up. He didn't end up let her he didn't give her the full season. He didn't let her buy her own clothes. Apparently he dresses her how he sees fit.
She doesn't get to meet people. She doesn't get to go to events. Like, she, it's hard for me to read about women who are just like so self-conscious and like so down on themselves.
But he calls her ugly. He calls her dowdy.
Yeah, exactly. It's one thing to just have that character, but you are actually seeing it in the making. You are seeing how terrible he treats her. You are seeing how people are reinforcing these ideas of how he feels about her and says things about her, including, which is interesting, the man she ends up with, Elias, who basically when we first meet him is like, well, that's not very nice, but also like, accurate. You know, I don't really think anything about her. Like, you know, she's whatever. And they've known each other for years, but also not really. Like, they've just kind of been in like each other's spheres, social spheres, because he happens to be good friends with Val, who, by the way, I want a whole story for Val, who's going to be the new Duke that takes over after mean old Duke dies. And he needs a story. I want a Val story.
I have to admit, when you were reading the book blurb, I finally made the connection of why they said Cupid, Valentine, Cupid.
Oh my God. Never put that together. So thank you.
As soon as I heard the Cupid reference, I was like, and it makes sense now.
And from reading these two stories, we know that Val is kind of the one constant throughout, like, other than just like either talk of the Duke and the fact that it's his party. Val is very present in both stories so far, because he happens to be good friends with both of the male leads. So I like Val a lot. And honestly, I'm like, I need somebody to write him his own love story.
So I have to admit, it takes me a little bit of time to fall into it with like the characters sometimes, like, oh, do I love you? Do I like you? What's going on with you?
Sure.
But he won me over right away. I mean, probably from the third page he's on, because again, her father is treating her terribly. He's taking away the Scottish estate, which was actually in Val's family until he won it in a card game, which everyone thinks he cheated at.
Cheated.
So again, he's a really great father and a great guy. But he said, I'll take care of her. I'll give her a dowry. I'll give her some place to stay, some place to, you know, I will, no matter what happens, I will make sure she's cared for. And I was so happy that Val made that offer and just flat out said that, like, there was no questions. He took ownership.
Yep.
There was agency. He didn't wait. He wasn't going to let her worry. So many times in historical novels, you're going to get the new male heir, and he kind of leaves the old female, who's not the heir, the daughter or whatever, who else is the female relation. They leave him hanging, worrying for their future. And I appreciated, like, right from the get-go, he's going, I will take care of her. This will not be a problem. Meanwhile, the father is making it a problem. But I appreciated Val stepping up to the plate like that.
I did too, because before we even meet Val, we just kind of hear mean old Duke talking about, like, oh, I'm going to give this to your cousin, he's gonna run the thing, the, you know, whatever we run, I don't, the dukedom. And I was like, oh God, he sounds like a, you know, the nephew that's like grubbing for, you know, power. And thankfully that's not him. So, and we've seen him across both stories play matchmaker and kind of, you know, try to push his friends a little bit towards these ladies that challenge them. And of course it's worked out wonderfully so far. So I can't wait to see what his role is in the other stories too.
I have to admit too, I like the fact that he's not giving the Duke's revelry it's the life of its own. This Duke is horrible. He refers to the revelry as his legacy, not his children, this party, that he's also not the one behind. He just said, I want a party. And then the daughter has been apparently, she started planning it when she was 15. And at the time of the story, when it begins, she's 23. So she's been planning this for a while now. And so Val is only going to keep it going for 10 years because that is the bargain he struck. And the only reason he really wants the Scottish estate is because his father, on his deathbed, that was the promise he made. He's not taking it because it's something he actually wants for himself. It's to honor his father's wishes. So again, I'm giving Val a pass of like, okay, I understand, you know, this was her dowry, but you have your reasons and I respect them. But I thought that was kind of nice that he was kind of going to put a time limit on the revelry, because if he had kind of just said, oh yeah, I'll keep it going until infinity, that kind of would have made it feel as if the Duke won. And this guy, you don't really want him to feel like he's winning.
No, I want him to lose everything, which I think he wholeheartedly deserves. You know what was one thing that was a little confusing for me, but I think I've wrapped my brain around it, is that in the first story, we have Cressida, who, like you said, she's 23. She's the daughter of the Duke. And at the very beginning of the story, she's talking about Isabelle. Isabelle, who is the heroine of the second story, but Isabelle is the Duke's granddaughter, and she's like a decade older than Cressida. So I was just like, oh my God, I want to know what this family's dynamic is. The fact that this man has all these children, where all of Cressida's siblings are like married and have children. And not only do they have children who are just as old, if not older, than her. Like, her niece is older than her.
Like, I mean, it's the whole like male and historical novel.
Yeah, it was very like, you know, just picturing like King Henry VIII, you know, like lots of like those kinds of relationships where you're like, oh yeah, so he probably had this daughter when he was like 70 and had all these other daughters who were already grown and wed and, you know, moved on and have their own children. And so I was like, well, this is a weird, especially as an only child, this is just a weird dynamic for me to even fathom. So that threw me for a loop for sure. But I like it. Why not?
I mean, I will admit, I think it's interesting when you start to think of it in context like that, of how he treated her, because he really did want to keep her tied to him, tied to the estate. Mm-hmm. The whole idea of him choosing dresses that would not flatter her figure and choosing things, saying she only gets 3 weeks off a year. So she has no time off. She's always planning this revelry. Like, he's isolating her and doing so many things to this one child. It's almost as if she's the last, she's the only one I have left. She's the one I'm going to keep right here, right with me. And it's so troubling and sick.
There's a lot of psychology we could like read into it. And the fact is, it's like a 100-page like novella where you're like, oh my gosh, I have so many questions. And that was kind of, Angela and I talked about this a little bit before we started recording, but so far I'm really enjoying this anthology. I am. I think the second story, the Christi Caldwell story, maybe worked a little bit more for me, just in terms of it being like a complete story. Like, we have an exes to lovers. It's 10 years after that they've been together. You know, they're all grown up now and they've never really fallen out of love. Great. I can buy into like a quick holiday story with that. Add in a little bit of Christmas magic and, you know, it's fine. But the first one, I do also very much enjoy, and I especially love Elias, because what's great about this story is Elias is just like such a puppy in love. Like, he goes from indifferent to, damn, I gotta get that.
He literally follows her out of the room. Like, as soon as she gets up to leave.
Multiple times.
Yeah, he's like right on heels. Multiple times.
And so it's great because it's like you have a different dynamic in this story. I will say, I think that the Eloisa James story, the one with Elias and Cressida, I think I would have preferred it as a full-length novel. I think I would have preferred spending a little bit more time getting to know the two of them individually, getting to know them together, without it being that he just kind of falls madly in love with her. It really is like a love at first glance almost sort of thing. And that's not my favorite. Insta-love is not my go-to. I do think if you like Insta-love, you'll probably love this story. And the two of them are very, very precious. Like, they're a great combination. And I love his relationship with Val as well. He's a really decent dude. Like, both the guys are stand up men, like no asshole or alpha hole whatsoever between them, which I like. I really do like. But that was basically my overall takeaway, was that I could have used a longer story for the first novella. The second one, I could have used a longer story too, but I think it works better as a novella.
No, I'm nodding right along with you. My issue with the first one, when you say insta-love, is, I actually am one of those people who are like, I love insta-love, but it doesn't really work here because she's known him since she was 5 years old. Oh my gosh, she's all that movie with Freddie Prinze Jr. where all of a sudden, oh, she changed her hair.
Where it's like they get the hot makeover, they take down their ponytail kind of. Yeah. That's so funny.
That's what it made me feel like.
I can see that.
That's kind of what I got a little bit, because it was one of those, oh, now all of a sudden I see you. Now all of a sudden that I see you, I love you. And so that one,
I see it.
It doesn't give me the insta love feelings, because usually it's the, as soon as you look at this character, they're
in. That's a good point.
And so I think that's one of the issues I had. It is insta love, but it isn't. And you're one of those, how do I, what gray line am I on right now?
Right. Like, if you're going to commit to one, commit to it and make it be an instant attraction. Yeah. And you're right. It's not, the only way I can explain it is that, you know, that he knew her mostly when she was a child. And so, like, because he shares this little anecdote of, like, when she was 5 years old and she, like, was ice skating and, like, ran into him or whatever. And he was like, a teenager at the time. And so, obviously, thank God there was no attraction at that point. It's almost like re-meeting her. Like, when he re-meets her as an adult, then it's more like he falls for her personality.
I will admit, it did take me a second to like him, because the father is very down on his daughter. He flat out calls her plain, and he calls her dowdy, and yet he also said that. He said she's plain. The only way she's going to get a husband is if she has a dowry. And I'm going, oh, man. I'm like, I know Val's the cousin, but is he the love interest? Because as soon as he said that, I was like, that's terrible.
No, and Val and Elias, you know, buy into it. They're like, she's like, I'll pay you for, you know, taking her. Whatever. It is very she's all that, now that I think about it. No, I mean, I think it's one of those times where you're like, okay, but then he sits down with her and, like, gets to know her, and, like, he falls for her generosity and her he really loves her brilliance. Mm-hmm. He loves how smart she is, and the fact that she has, you know, this head for numbers, and, like, she's put together this incredible event that apparently is life-changing for everyone in England. Who
That's
knew?
How he won me back, because he fell in love with the right things, let's say. Like, he fell in love with her saying, like, oh, yeah, I remember this King Arthur, and here's this little flute that I made. Like, he fell in love with the way her mind works and how she operates. So when you said that, I'm nodding. I'm like, yeah, that's how he got me back. He might have called her plain and had some lines and stuff, but, you know.
And he does, and he kind of corrects himself over time, where he's like, you know what? It's not even that, like, oh, she's not pretty, but at least she's smart. It's that, no, she is beautiful. She is very, very pretty. But, like, one, her father has instilled in her the idea that she's not. And because of that, she doesn't, you know, dress a certain way. She doesn't present herself a certain way. And two, she just has, like, such low confidence that it's hard to even have the opportunity to, like, you can't even call her beautiful, because otherwise she like, freaks out about it and thinks you're, like, joking. And you know, it's a lot, honestly, it's a lot of baggage to, like, deal with in the span of a 100-page novella. That being said, I think we're making it sound like it's, like, a tragedy, and really, it's very cute.
No. Yeah. I mean, I will admit, I got the biggest kick. This is a really random thing to draw on, but she has a lot of hair. So I have long hair, but her hair is longer. Apparently it's down to, you know, the small of her back there. And so the first night, when they're adults again and they're re-meeting, he thinks she's wearing a wig. And her hair's on the top of her head. And apparently the woman who did her hair didn't secure the pins. So when she eventually gets up to leave, she's dropping pins behind her. And he's like, oh, it's like Hansel and Gretel. We can find her with the breadcrumbs.
I thought that was so cute. I thought that was so cute.
The part that kills me, though, is the next time he sees her, she's got her hood up and she's wearing the jacket. And then eventually the hood falls down. He's like, oh, you're still wearing the hair. She's like, this is much as you're wearing your hair.
This is my hair.
He was convinced that she was wearing a wig. And then he, like, at one point, he's like, is she bald? Because that hood is, like, actually to, like, her head. Wait, what's going on there? The hood's falling flat. Does she have hair? And so this is his inner monologue. She doesn't know any of this, but he's wondering, like, is she bald under there? So one of my notes was, I kind of had trouble thinking of this as a Christmas story, which is a very odd thing to say because it's supposed to be all about Christmas.
No, but fair.
But no, so the reason why I say that is because she's being forced to plan this Christmas party. And so she resents the Christmas party. This isn't the Hallmark movie where we have our tree decorating competition. We have our baking competition and we fall in love as this is being planned out and as this is occurring. And so the fact that she's forced to plan this party makes me resent it a little bit. And so then I feel myself resenting the Christmas party, which is supposed to be the biggest part of the story.
Well, and really, she doesn't actually get to enjoy a lot of the festivities in not even like in terms of like personal enjoyment, but just like she's not even really there. Like it's she's the behind the scenes, you know, of the puppet master. And so the one thing that she does love and that we get to see her love is the grotto, the winter grotto that's like this big snow sculpture theme. And like, oh, this year it's King Arthur and there's Merlin's cave, which of course they steam up. And I very much appreciate it, by the way. Anytime people go out in the snow in holiday books, I'm like, are y'all gonna do it in the snow? Please do it in the snow. Please.
Are you gonna get frostbite?
Yeah. And that would be my second thought. So I do love, though, that they got to have like a little steamy moment in the snow.
That wasn't my favorite part of the book, because here's this thing that she's worked so hard on creating, and that is the most important part of the entire event to her, is the grotto. And she talks about how it's living art and how you can't truly encapsulate it and have it live on after the event, and how that is such a big part of what she likes about it. And she goes down into the smallest details talking about the lanterns and how the lanterns have this sort of lighting, and there's this encasement here so that they have to change the lanterns every day so that there are new ones to have that same lighting effect. I mean, she's given this thing a lot of thought, and this is where you can tell Eloisa James is a writing goddess, is because you can visually just, you know exactly what's going on. You're imagining this as the scene is unfolding before you. I mean, that is not an easy piece of writing when you really think about it. And she nailed it.
I think both Eloisa James and Christi Caldwell did a really good job of kind of weaving in this small message in each of their stories that is so applicable to modern audiences. And this is what I love about historical romance that's being published today, is a lot of it is kind of taking modern ideals and modern topics and modern debates that we're having and putting it in a historical context so that you can still connect with it and you can still identify with it, but in a safer space that's a lot more removed from the reality we live in, because we also don't want to just continuously read about like the harsh realities. And so in this one, in Eloisa James's novella, it's very much like, oh, well, let's appreciate the time we have and we're here together. You know, he hasn't had the opportunity to, he's never really taken the time to look at the grottos and admire the grottos, because it's just another party. It's just another year. But she kind of makes him slow down, appreciate this. You're never going to see something like this ever again. And I think that's really beautiful, not just for the holidays, but all year. And then with Christi Caldwell's story, you know, we have two people who very much are passionate about the work that they do. And it's kind of called into question of, why can you want him to work less and spend more time with you if you're also not willing to do the same thing? Like, if you're both passionate about what you do, why stand in the way of that? Like, you can still be together and also be passionate about your work. And I think those are both concepts that are so, so modern. Like, these are things that we've talked about, especially during the pandemic, that I love that they had that in there in this short novella that takes place 200 years before our own time. Like, it's so impressive to me that you can communicate that and basically reaffirm these ideas that we're talking about in 2021.
I think exactly what you said is right on point. They definitely were able to, I feel like this is the Tessa Dare, this is the Tessa Dare moment. And when you take sort of this modern feminism and you put it in this historical time period, like, that's how I think of it. I'm like, this is a Tessa Dare moment. This is a Tessa Dare.
That's why I love Tessa Dare books.
But that was actually one of my notes about how they made it feel modern in that way.
I'm excited to read the next two stories and see where it goes from here. And like, what do we get to see, other sides of the revelry? Do we get to see other events that are happening? I don't know. Let's also talk a little bit about Wishing Under the Mistletoe. I know that we've kind of referenced this throughout, but this is the Christi Caldwell story. It's the second novella in this anthology. And this is the one that's kind of reminiscent of A Christmas Carol, We have an exes to lovers sort of situation. I will say one of the things I do like, and I know I mentioned this with the weird family dynamic of Isabelle being the granddaughter of the Duke, rather than Cressida as the daughter. She's, when the romance really begins, she's 33. Like, she's in her 30s. And for that time period, I mean, you don't hear a lot about women in their 30s still being, one, invited to events like this, you know, and also the fact that she's basically made her life for the last decade as a playwright and a director and studying the art of theater with this German, you know, theater artist, that I was like, this is really cool. Like, this is great, especially it spoke to my theater kid heart of like, wow, I don't know if it would have worked out quite as well for me in this time period. However, good to know that there were, you know, women that were going out and pursuing their dreams and really kind of putting work first, because that's sort of like how I've always spent my life. And that's not to say it's the way to do it. I mean, everybody has their own priorities. I just know for me, work and my passion projects have always taken a very high precedence in my life. And so I really connected a lot with Isabelle. And I will say there were certain conversations she had with both Cyrus and her sister, Maeve, where they kind of like give her a talking to, where they're like, look, this is great. But also there were moments that they had those chats that I was like, ooh, this is really making me have to think a lot about myself and my priorities.
Oh no, I feel like you're preaching to the choir with everything you're saying. I'm nodding. I feel like that Christina Aguilera gif where she's like, preach with the arm up in the air. That's what I feel like right now.
A classic.
Because you mentioned this earlier, one of the problems was that Cyrus was putting his work first. He was spending more time hovering over the books than with her. And once you start unpacking it, there are other issues at play with her loving the theater and him never going to the theater with her. There's a lot more to their relationship when they first began in the prologue, but she realizes he does end up working. He ends up getting this letter, and the timing of this wasn't exactly great because they were just intimate, and all of a sudden he has this letter about, oh, you can go buy the mines for your business partner Marley. And so I think the timing of it is what really shook her, was the fact, hey, we just had this very intimate moment and now you're going off to business. But he still was helping her. He still did have that moment with her. She ended up having to realize it's not all or nothing. He can't just be with you all the time and not have anything to do. There is a balance, and he's getting that right, you know, now that he's in his 30s, because he's 35 when this novel, at the start of the story. And so she realized, hey, wait a second, he is working. We can have our moments. We can find a balance. That wasn't the case before. Before, he was just choosing work. There never would have been that intimate moment. So that was the problem.
And also with her, you know, when they were engaged when they were younger, they were, you know, in their early 20s, and she wasn't a playwright yet. She wasn't like off. She hadn't gone to explore what she wanted to explore. So in that regards, I'm like, well, of course you wanted him to make you the center of his universe then, because you didn't have anything for yourself. Like, you didn't have anything. And that kind of becomes, you know, a part of the message later on too, is like, look, we just weren't ready for each other at that time. Like, he says something to her about like, I wasn't ready for you then. And that is, that is so real. Like, that is so real, where it's like, you can meet someone, they could be Prince fucking Charming, and it's just like, if it's not right in that moment for both of you, then it might just not be the time.
This one, I think, is my first for Christi, and I really did enjoy it. I have my notes in front of me, and I'm like, oh, I liked this scene, I liked that. I think she did a very good job of integrating the classic Christmas elements with the story, but at the same time, she did so many great romance writer things. Mm-hmm. Again, I'm someone with insomnia, so maybe this was why my mind was like, oh, they're, neither of them can sleep. They're both up late. So they both go to the music room, and there's this moment where she's looking at him going, Cyrus, why did you come here? Why didn't you go to the library? Why didn't you go to the den? And you realize he went there because that's her favorite room. That's what she's interested in. And just subtle things like that just hit home for the romance readers. Those are the things where you get to see, oh, he really does love her. Oh, he really is, you know, wanting to be around her. And even just little things about Cyrus having lines about, he wasn't familiar with Cinderella. And when she's describing it, she mentions the evil stepsisters. And he goes, well, wouldn't you want to portray a happy family? Just having cute little lines and dialogue and interactions like that, they add up and they make it a great story.
Yeah, he was a precious angel because, like, we find out that he grew up, you know, on the lower class level versus where she grew up. Also, great subtle commentary about, like, privilege in this story. Like, very subtle, but it's there. And I did appreciate that. But he didn't know Cinderella. He was less familiar with, like, you know, pantomime because, like, he hasn't been to the revelry before. This is actually his first revelry. And the only reason he's invited is because he happens to be on good terms with Val, who is not only a friend, but also technically his employer. I loved that we got to see sort of like an outsider's perspective, because in the first story, both Cressida and Elias have been going to the revelry for years. And so it was nice to see somebody who, this was their first visit to the revelry, and they kind of had a jaded view of it to begin with because of that difference in, like, social class. So I liked his fresh perspective.
I also have to admit, Isabelle is she's not a party girl, but she's the life of the party, where she likes when people are interacting. She likes when people are engaging. She likes that they're playing the games. And she tries to draw that out in him because Cyrus is very much the brooding, stoic, I feel uncomfortable. I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that he knows he wasn't brought up with these people. And so they look down on him, or he thinks they're looking down on him. And so he has his own insecurities at play. And meanwhile, she's trying to drag him out to be the, you know, dancing on the floor, be playing the games with everyone else. And she's just so cute, though, because she's so happy about directing this play and being engaged with the theater and working with the revelry. She is just this little bright ray of sunshine. Yeah, this is where you get those Christmas vibes. The other one did feel a little bit like a darker Christmas vibe going on with, oh, this is the Christmas party. Yeah. Meanwhile, you get Isabelle, this is the Christmas party.
I love her.
Her tone is just it's so different.
Well, and, you know, as Hallmark vibes as you might get, I do want to mention that both of these stories have heat. Like, they both have on the page sex scenes. I appreciate it on several levels, starting with the fact that there are so many holiday romances that don't have heat at all. Like, they're very much closed door stories, and that's fine. Not a problem. I will review them all. However, I prefer to have some heat in my romance. And also, they're novellas. They're short. And so I'm going into most holiday romances thinking, you know what? Probably not going to be heat, but if it shows up, awesome. And so with this one, I was like, well, I've got two things working against me, because one, it's a holiday romance. And secondly, they're short stories, and yet they delivered. And so as much as I did enjoy the love scene in the first story, it's that one is very much like a tender lovemaking scene. And it's not my preferred sort of sex that I want to read.
I will admit, I liked the thought process behind it.
Yeah.
I feel as if this was one of those Me Too movement, you know, this is something that writers are doing now. I feel as if Eloisa James had one of those commentaries going on where she said, I don't want to have sex with you just because we're married. I want to give myself to you before our marriage so that it means something.
Because he wanted to wait. He was like, I don't want to take something from you that, like, you're not ready for. I thought, and he goes down on her first. I was like, ooh, all right, sir. This is good. For me, I liked the second story's sex scenes a lot more. Like, we have and there's like a full length sex scene, and then there's one where it's more of like they're having their hookup on the piano. In fact, I think both times that they hook up are on the piano, but one time just goes a little bit further. But you can tell from the way they are talking about it that, like, they have been together in the past. And I love a guy who just, like, grips those thighs, man. He is a thigh gripper. He, like, slides his hands up and, like, grabs them and is, like, moving her around on the piano. I'm like, yes, that is my peanut butter and jelly. So I do have a short segzerpt that I would like to share from Christi Caldwell's story. If you have one to share as well, you are welcome to. So the segzerp that I chose is from when they actually do have sex on the piano. Because the first time it's like a little bit of foreplay and then they get interrupted. And so this time is when they're back on the piano. How uncomfortable. And it makes me think of that scene from Pretty Woman. And I'm just like, mm-mm. But so he, let's see. Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay. So in the first story, he goes down on her. In this story, he's just kind of like diddling her a little bit. So as Cyrus palmed her moist curls, not my favorite phrasing, both with moist and curls, but we'll let it go.
I was going to say the word yep. moist. Is that the
As
word?
Cyrus palmed her moist curls, Isabelle let her legs fall open. That slight shifting of her body allowed him full access to the place he so ached to touch again. He slipped one digit inside her. Get ready for this one. Channel. Heat. He was all... Or she was all, he probably was too, but she was all wet heat that slicked the way for his touch. Cyrus, Isabelle cried softly against his mouth. Nothing more than his name pulled from her in desire, and it sent another bolt of lust through him. His shaft rose higher, and he swelled all the more. It's like it just keeps growing. And as he slipped another finger inside and another and began to stroke her, he arched against her hip. You know, that's a good scene. That's a good segsurpt, but like, I wish I had chose one where he was like, gripping her thighs, because I did really, this was like a thigh gripping story. Like there was several moments where he's holding her thighs and I got big thighs. So I love hearing about people touching thighs. My mistake. I'm sorry. I chose one that included shaft and moist and channel all in one passage, but you're welcome.
I really liked how we kind of didn't know the entirety of their relationship leading up to the engagement. We know that they were friends as mm-hmm. children, which eventually grew into childhood sweethearts, but we don't really find out that they engaged in the whole premarital sex with a historical right. setting until they're actually in the midst of rekindling and, yeah. And you know, going down that road again. And I kind of appreciated the fact that he said, "I missed touching her. She's the only woman." We actually find out in that moment that she's the only woman he's known like this. He even thinks to himself, "I hope I'm the only man she knows mm-hmm. like this." We don't find out her sexual history explicitly, but you can pretty much infer she's only been with him. But he just really loves her. And when he was in this moment with this sex scene, all of a sudden, all of the thoughts about how much he cares for her, how much this means to him, how he missed touching her like this, how everything about her he just loves and appreciates, all of the emotions just come flooding to the surface, because he's one of those very prim and proper men. And this isn't just him trying to fit into society. Right. This is him being very prim and proper. And so I liked the fact that this is when he's just totally unleashed, and not just with his actions, but with his thoughts about how much he loves her. I just really appreciated that.
Yeah. I'm very invested in this anthology. I don't think there's been any mention of the next two characters that we hear about in the synopsis, Lady Caroline Whitmore and Miss Louisa Harcourt. Those are the next two heroines in the next two novellas in this anthology. And like I said, I will be talking about them in a future episode, but I don't think there's been any mention of either of them so far. So I'm going mm-hmm. into those blind moving forward from here. Although I do hope we continue to see Cressida and, you know, Isabelle and the men and everything. So what about you? Do you think you'll read the remainder of the anthology?
I think I'm curious, because I think I want to know more about this revelry. With this one, we very much got a sneak peek into one side of it in particular with the theater, but we still have all the other things going on throughout the right. 2 week period that we still have questions about. We were learning about the revelry, what was allowed, what wasn't allowed, but I just wanted to flag this because I don't, you know, spoiler alert with the ending. We all know these are romances, happily ever afters. They're going to end up together.
What? So
this isn't really a spoiler alert. but they do end up together. But I did want to flag this moment because she adds a show. And I wanted to ask you about this too, your thoughts. And I also want to kind of flag this for readers and people who are going to be picking up the stories, because I found the scene really interesting. It did pay homage to A Christmas Carol with the Ghost of Christmas yes. Past. He's reliving the moment. Isabelle's on stage recreating their breakup, and we get to see his reactions in the moment of, oh, I should have said that. Oh, I should have said this. Oh, yeah, I see now. She was hoping for me to make a moment right. there. Oh, I, did I really... Did I really say that? Did I really not do this? Did she? Oh, now I understand what's going on. And so we have that nice juxtaposition of the here, you know, the here and now to the past. But here's a guy who's very prim and proper and is worried about his place in society. And here's this girl who puts on a big production, and she actually singles him out in the audience and walks towards him and gets on her knee and proposes.
It's the grand gesture. But in this case, we're seeing... So here's my thing. I love that the heroine makes the grand gesture. I am here for it. I am 100% here for it. I do not love the grand gesture itself. I get that it's related to her as a theater artist. Fine. Yeah. I get that she's basically... creating a play that really is not a play. I mean, it's very much just like her reenacting the time they broke up, which I'm like, that's not, I don't see how that would be romantic in any way. But
the moment you left him.
But at the same time, it's kind of that whole idea of like, well, but he, even while watching it, is like, ooh, I'm looking at this with fresh eyes, 10 years older, and seeing like what I shoulda, coulda, woulda done. And my answer is that I like that. I'm not a big fan of grand gestures in general. It's honestly not my thing in romance. If you do them in a romance novel, they have to make sense for the character. Like, I don't want somebody to just sing somebody a song because, like, are they a singer? Are they in a rock band? Fine. It makes sense. This one, it did make sense in the context. She's a theater artist. It's a play. I could have done without it. I didn't need it. Like, I don't know. It was probably my least favorite part of that particular story.
So I ended up rereading that scene a couple of times because I was trying to figure out how I felt about it. And I liked it up in, I mean, again, I don't want to say liked. I'm saying liked in quotes because if I were in that situation with airing our dirty laundry to her entire family. I would not exactly have been a happy little camper. But I liked the scene up until she broke away and it became that whole, oh, fourth wall, we're breaking. I liked the reenactment portion because that paid homage to the original Christmas, you know, a Christmas Carol. I liked that part of it because that was, again, my literary side coming out going, oh, this is the original adaptation. Right. But as soon as she started integrating their real life off the stage moments, I was like, how do you phrase that? You're the theater person.
No, but you're right. Breaking the fourth wall. Like, she approaches.
Yeah. And that was when I sort of kind of cringed.
What's funny is I actually like that part better than the first part because the first part to me, I understand like them looking at it from fresh eyes, but I'm like, why is this the moment that you want to revisit? Like, this has already happened. Like, I don't like people dwelling on the past. I don't like it when people are like, let's look at this and see what we could have done differently. But it's like 10 years have passed. Like, you can't change that moment. I like when she approaches him because it's kind of like, we don't have an ending to this story yet. I need your help.
Oh, that's a cute way
to write this ending. But the whole thing is cringeworthy. I'm with you. Like, it's very cringeworthy. I'm just like, oh my God, you are airing so much dirty laundry, spilling all the tea in front of all these influential people in society. And like, what if this goes poorly? Like, what if this goes wrong? Like, you guys have been in a fight. I don't know if this is the time that I would, one, want to apologize, two, share the details of our sordid past, and three, propose, for God's sakes. Like, it's a lot. Yeah. It is a lot.
That was the scene where I'm going, this is, like, I don't know how to fully unpack this.
I'm with you. I do like that she's the one to kind of reach out to him. And it's also kind of a nice shift from the Eloisa James story, which is a lot more of him having to make amends with her. And so so far what I really appreciate is that we're seeing people who were on different sides of this party. We're seeing people from different socioeconomic backgrounds. We're seeing people who are approaching the relationships in different ways. You know, we have exes to lovers. We have not really enemies to lovers, but just sort of like meeting again as strangers. And so it's nice to see that they're doing different things. So I'm just wondering, and judging by the synopsis for the upcoming stories, I know that we have one that sounds like a
like an estranged marriage in trouble, but then also having to fake being together. That sounds like my bread and butter. Like, that is what I want to read right there.
I love a good marriage of convenience story. Oh,
the best.
I love those stories. And they're so terrible when you start because they're just, they hate each other. They're button heads. Yep. But when they find that common ground, oh, all the feelings, yeah. The heart swells.
This is a tough one too, because I'd love to give this, what we, you know, normally do to close out the episodes is give the book a few ratings for heart, humor, heat. And because it's the holiday season, we've added an extra H and we rate for holiday. However, I'm going to ask you, I think, to, and we'll do it, you know, very quickly, considering we've talked so much about each of the stories, to just give a rating for each story, as opposed to like the anthology as a whole, because we haven't read the entire anthology. So
oh, that sounds fair to me. I like the sound of that.
Let's start with A Mistletoe Kiss by Eloisa James. And this is Cressida and Elias's story. Mm-hmm. So what do you think as far as the heart rating goes?
I think he's such a cute little cinnamon roll sometimes. The way he just adores her. And I also appreciate the wit in their dialogue back and forth. When he mm-hmm. says, oh, we're getting married. She goes, you're declaring that. You didn't ask. You got to ask. I think that there's a lot of heart to this one. Mm-hmm. And the fact that she's also dealing with insecurities and there's a lot of emotional components to her character growth. I think you got to give this one a pretty high heart rating. I almost want to say at least an 8 or a 9.
Yeah, I put like an 8, 8.5. Like, I'm definitely with you on that one. I think the heart is probably going to be my highest rating for this particular novella. So I think we're in the same ballpark on that one. How about humor, which I feel like is going to be a interesting one. Although I will say, I do think there are humorous moments. Like, I'm not going to do a not applicable, because I do think, especially with Elias's pursuit of her, that there are these funnier, lighter moments.
Oh yeah. It's one of those, there are definitely comedic scenes, dialogue, and it almost to me feels as if there'll be like a very straight line and then a spike and then a very straight line yes. and then a spike. And so it makes it difficult to really give this a fair rating, because when he thought she was wearing a horse's hair on her head, I mean, that was ridiculous and hysterical. And you're going, oh my goodness, Eloisa James, I am just loving this. So that was all of the humor. That scene and that ongoing joke was a 10 out of 10. But was this a humorous story unto itself? Not so much. So I'm like, right. Do I give this a 6 or a 7? Like, there's humor, but it's not there every single other page. This isn't a Jill Shalvis novel where like you're just constantly smiling throughout. Like, this one will pull at your heartstrings, and some of it's a little bit difficult to read. So you can't be like, oh, this is the most humorous story ever. So mm-hmm, I want to give it a fair rating, but it's hard. So I want to say like a 6, 7.
That's fine. I mean, I gave it a 5 because I feel like I'm with you. It's like it's halfway funny. Like, there are funny moments. I like some of the dialogue. Is it overall a rom-com? Absolutely not. So, and that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. But we just have to make sure people know going in. How about heat? For this one, we have it. It's there. There's also some steamy kisses, a potential hookup. So I think I might bump it up to maybe a 6.
Yeah, that's why I was kind of pausing. I'm going, well, they have the love scene, but as you said before, it's very tender. It's not exactly we're having a hot and heavy moment. You're going, oh, this is the passion on, you know, coming to life off the page. So it's very sweet, the love scene itself.
Right.
So I think that's why I was kind of hesitating, because it's there, but it's not super explicit and it's not super, super steamy. Like, there's steam, but we're not going to, it's not the Titanic where all of a sudden the hand's there and like it's leaving the mark. She's laughing at me.
Steam, more of like a light mist. Yeah. You know, just like a light dusting of fog.
Can we get new t-shirts and bookmarks that say this? Because this is hysterical.
I think my favorite thing somebody said this year was that it's not a closed door romance, but it's not necessarily like an explicit sex scene. It's more of like door ajar with the latch still on. And I was like, yes, that is exactly, I completely understand where you're at.
Was this one of your podcast interviews?
It is. Yeah. It's, I think it was, I'm trying to remember what book it was. I want to say it was Accidentally Engaged, Farah Haran book, which was great and really funny. And you have a hero who has a foot fetish, but at the same time, the sex they have is like very minimal and like just a sneak little peek through that cracked door.
I'm like, I have so many questions. Was like whipped cream placed on toes at some point? Like, what's going on?
I wish. You know what? If they write it, I'll read it. But it's there. It's on the page. The door is open, you know, but are we banging down the door? No, it's just open.
You're just like knocking on it gently.
Yeah. Like just it creaks a little bit. Now, how about holiday ranking for this one? Because I know you said you were maybe missing like a little more of like the holiday festivities.
I mean, I think my issue with it for a quote unquote holiday read is that she's being forced to work on the holiday party.
Right.
And so because she's our protagonist, we're following the story through her eyes, and you see how poorly she's being treated in regard to this holiday party. Her entire right. life is revolving around it, and it makes it hard to root for this as a holiday book because you want her to escape. You're like, oh, is New Year's coming? Do you get your 3 weeks off now?
Yeah. I
mean, you want her to be more than just the Christmas holiday planner for her father, at least. And so it's hard for me to give this a holiday rating. I want to say I'll be a generous 4 or 5, but I can't give this one a super high holiday rating.
No, I'm with you because the moments that they're out in the grotto are beautiful. And those are very much more of like a winter vibe than like a,
exactly,
than a holiday vibe, because they're looking at like these snow sculptures. And
they're looking
I'm like,
at King Arthur. They're not even looking at anything Christmas related.
It's not even like it's a Christmas carol or something, you know, that wasn't even written yet, but you know what I mean?
I know what you mean.
Where it's not necessarily like reminiscent of Christmas that they're looking at in the snow. And
it's not even King Arthur's Christmas. It's just King Arthur and his mistresses.
King Arthur.
I mean, just throwing that out there. He's not even celebrating any sort of holiday. It's about him and he has a potential offspring. She's like, that's the baby flute. So again, nothing
there. And
then
there's Merlin in a cave, you know? I mean, it's great. It's creative. Is it Christmas? No. And then what's funny is that there's this giant party that's going on that is supposed to be the be-all, end-all of all, you know, holiday party hooplas in England. And we don't really get to see it that much. And when we do, you're absolutely right, Angela. It's not in like a positive light because it's such a burden on Cressida's character. And so I think I'm only going to give it like a 3 or a 4 for holiday. Now, I think that'll change with future stories in this anthology, depending on how much of the party we get to explore. And I think even as we go into our ratings for Christi Caldwell's story, Wishing Under the Mistletoe, I think my holiday rating will even be like a little bit higher for that one.
Yeah.
Just because, again, it's not just the holiday. It's like how the characters are like treating the holiday. And Cressida's not a fan, and rightfully so, because they treat her like shit. So
can't blame her. I mean, this poor girl, her entire life revolves around the holiday party.
Yes.
And it's, again, it's not as if she even gets to partake in it.
There's so many people who don't like the holiday season for that reason. Exactly. It's like, it's more of like a chore where it's, oh, I have to do this, and it has to look like this, and it has to taste like that. And that's so tough. Like I try my best not to do that, but as like a type A personality, I know that I will fall into that in certain places. But I feel like the older I get, the more understanding I am, not only of things not maybe going exactly according to plan, but just of like, it's okay to make mistakes. It's okay for things, because sometimes they turn out to be even better. That being said, let's talk about, I already forgot the name of it again, Wishing Under the Mistletoe. How let's start with Hart rating again. What do you think?
So I think that this one is a little bit harder to classify because Cyrus is very much the stoic Mr. Darcy type. He doesn't necessarily say what he's feeling. And same thing can be said for our leading lady there, Isabelle.
Mm-hmm.
That the communication being an issue for them, that's kind of the problem with the heart, because the thing that they're not saying is their feelings. So I almost want to say like a 6.5, maybe 7, because they're not vocalizing a lot of their feelings for at least the first third. And then they definitely start picking it up, and then they start having those conversations. They start learning about the past. And I think it amps up for the last one third being a lot higher with the rating. So then I'm like, oh, it's a full on 8, because he's talking about his childhood, how she's relating to him like this. And I think so for me, the heart level kind of changes throughout the duration of the read.
That makes sense. And I think you're right. Like, because I feel like the heart level is inherently going to be a little bit higher when you're talking about somebody who, like a couple who has a built-in relationship. Like, because they've been together before, it's going to be a lot easier for us to like buy into them getting together again in such a short amount of time. Like, because there's so much history, there's so many feelings that still exist. But at the same time, he is very, very broody, which I hate myself for being attracted to. And she's the opposite. She's very outgoing and way too similar to myself for comfort, but doesn't want to talk about her feelings. Again, way too similar for comfort. I think I'll give it a 7. I think I'll give it like a 7, 7.5.
I love how you're like, it's the indirect heart. It's the subtlety of the heart. It's
there. Like, I know that they're feeling things. Are they telling each other they're feeling things? No, but I wouldn't be either because I keep my feelings to myself. Yeah, no.
It's- Do you know what you just reminded me of? You reminded me of that scene in Pride and Prejudice with the hands where he helps her into the carriage and then he flexes with the hand. There's no dialogue. There's no nothing, but you get all the heart.
And yet
the feelings.
So much is said.
That's what you just gave him. Like, yeah, that is the heart rating right there.
So true. People know exactly what that hand is and what that hand means. So that's powerful. Like, to be able to see a hand and be like, ooh, I know that hand. Now, how about the humor in this one? Which it's a funny divide where I'm like, is it funnier than the last one? Maybe, but then also. No, I don't, you know, I feel like when opposites attract and like sort of enemies to lovers, I feel like that situation creates a lot of humor just in general. So I don't know. I might think this one is like a little bit funnier than the last one, but I don't know if it is. Like, maybe I'm just lying to myself. I think I'm going to go ahead though. And if I gave the last one a 5 for humor, I think I might give this one a 6 and just like bump it up a little bit.
Again, this is probably my literary side where I'm going, for me, the tone is much brighter and lighter. So it's not,
I agree.
It's not necessarily comedic with, oh, we're having our laughs here. Whereas the other one I felt as if had a joke inserted or had a comedic thing inserted and that's what lightened it. Whereas this one just felt lighter throughout the duration of the narrative.
Right. That's not a rating. Give me a rating, Angela.
I'm just saying, I think that's why my rating for this one would definitely be like a 6 or something.
Okay, well then how about the heat for this one? Steamier than the last? Just as steamy? What do you think?
Well, I mean, they couldn't even wait to go to the bedroom, so we're going to have to knock up the steam factor with them.
Ooh, that piano room saw a lot of action in this story.
That piano, it was singing the melody of their love song, which is what they were, I think that's what the author said at one point. She's like, this was our song. I'm going, okay.
Singing the melody of their love song. I love it.
Apparently they were hitting the notes as they were going at it. So
yeah, hit those high notes.
I'm not really sure what that song would have sounded like, but unto themselves, they have their own unique song for when they finally do tie the knot.
Yeah, the high, for me, this one was definitely steamier than the last one. Both, I liked the sex that they had more in this one. And, you know, obviously it's a short story. I will say, you know, to squeeze in a love scene or two into a short story, I think is a challenge unto itself. So I'm probably going to give the heat on this one like a point or two higher. So I'm going to say like closer to like 7.5 or 8 for this one.
I got to give it some sort of credit, too, because they didn't just have a sex scene. There was some foreplay to the sex scene in that piano room. It was from beginning to end with the, we're taking off our clothes to literally getting dressed again. And he has the handkerchief and they have aftercare and everything. So
yes.
I'm going to give it at least a 7, 7.5, maybe 8. Yeah, I'm right there with you.
Yeah.
I'm going to go a 7.5, 8.
Good stuff. Well, so like I said, I'm excited to read the next two stories in the book. It sounds like you'll probably get to them as well.
Oh yeah.
Obviously you have always a lot more reading to do come December and promoting and everything, as do I. So you can focus on your cozies. I can focus on the romance and we will get through the holidays and then maybe finally be able to think again and read something else.
Oh no, it's so funny because I feel as if I've been doing a lot of the comfort romance reading. I'm going, oh, where is my Ruth Ann Norton? Where is my Evangeline Anderson? I've been doing a lot of rereads lately. I definitely was nice to do something, to have a reason to read something different, to be like, no, yes. I got to go pick up a different book for a change. With COVID, I think everyone sort of has this new acceptance and appreciation for those comfort reads. And when you're having anxiety or struggles, people are totally on board with, I really love this book over here, so I'm going to go pick that up and go spend my afternoon over there and have my, you know, my perspective and my positivity just lifted. And I think that's what's been going on a lot of the time. And at least for me in particular, with reading books that I've already gone through before. And so to have a reason to pick up a holiday read was just, it was so great.
We've all been there. We have all been there on more than one occasion. So no, I'm thankful you joined me for, you know, another day of the 12 days of Boobsmas. And I have no doubt that 12 days of cozy will just be, you know, just as amazing as always.
Thank you.
No, let me take that back. It'll be better, you know, than before. And you know, as I already mentioned, and Angela put in for the, you know, where you can find and follow the Cozy Mystery Book Club on Instagram, on Twitter. You can sign up for the newsletter, enter to win that way. There are so many ways to engage with Angela and the club, you know, beyond the holiday season too. So the same can be said for the 12 days of Boobsmas. There will be plenty of chances to still win, plenty of more holiday romances to discuss. You can always check out previous episodes on our website, boobiesandnewbies.com.
And I highly recommend that you do, because as you can tell, she is hysterical and amazing.
Oh my gosh. You're my best endorsement. So thank you for that. But yeah, no, it's been a treat. And as always, you are, you know, more than welcome to come back and talk about romance, cozy, Sherlock, you know, whatever you want, anytime.
I truly think of you as like one of the closest online friends I've ever made. And it started with the dissertation where I was doing interviews and I've just kept you.
Yes.
I never let you go.
Kept me around. And here we are watching each other grow and helping to, you know, promote each other's platforms and guest on each other's shows. And I am always more than happy to do it. So I have no doubt that there will be many more collaborations in the future.
Oh, absolutely.
So much love. I love this love fest. Yeah, no, this has been delightful. And, you know, without further ado, I think the only thing left for us to do is say, on the second day of Boobsmas, my lover gave to me two nipple clamps.
On the second day of Boobsmas, my lover gave to me two nipple clamps and a heart hookup underneath the tree.
Thanks so much for listening. Boobies and Newbies is part of the Frolic Podcast Network. Find more podcasts you'll love at frolic.media/podcasts.